Peter chapter number 1, verse 8 and 9 says, whom having not seen you love. We have not seen Jesus, but we love him. Though now you see him not, yet believing, ye rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory, receiving the end of your faith, even the salvation of your souls. Just across the page, joy unspeakable. I found his grace. I found his grace. So much, you may be seated.
Well, good morning.
Good morning.
Good to see you. I want to do something a little different this morning. I'd like everyone to get up and walk around and shake hands with one another. Welcome those that are visiting this morning. And we want to say thank you for being with us.
I've seen you before. Sure is nice to
meet you.
Good to see you.
Good to see y'all.
Shipping one with another and a lot of hugs and a lot of welcoming. Good job, guys. Thank you, thank you. I appreciate y'all. It's good to see you. Now, how do you shut it off? I love it. All right. We had to bring the conversations to an end. good job. Wow. I may never do that again, but oh, what a blessing. Ain't it good to be in the house of the Lord today? Amen. We want to go to the Lord in prayer this morning, and I want to pray especially for our speaker that was to be here today, Ken Morton. He's had some kidney stones, and I got a call this morning at 8:30 that they were possibly taking him to the hospital. So Alton and Jeannie are dealing with him right now, and they're not here. But I want us to pray for him. He's a Wycliffe Bible translator, and he was coming to speak to us today and show us some slides and talk about his ministry. And we were going to take up a love offering for him. And this morning, what I want to do at the end of the service, I want you to pray about what God would have you to do. But I think we all ought to dig deep and give the love offering anyway. He drove over. He was on his way over, got to Tennessee, stopped in an emergency room, spent some time there, and came on and thought it was getting better. And last night he got about an hour's sleep. So he's having a lot of problems. He's supposed to be gone for 4 weeks raising money for his ministry and his family, and you know, these things happen. So pray for Ken and pray what God would have you to do. I'll have our deacons at the end of the service at each door with a offering plate, and I would love for each one of you to put something in. If you'd like to write a check, just make it out to our church, and we'll turn around and be able to write him a check. So let's pray for him this morning. Also, we want to pray for Alan Coates, who has been put back in the hospital, and pray for Lori and Cantrell. She's in rehab, and all those others. Remember Zoanne, she's got to go back in, and she'll be hearing from her doctor this week on some of her tests and other things. So we want to keep Zoanne in our prayers and pray for her. So let's go to the Lord in prayer this morning. Father, I want to thank you today for such a beautiful day you've given us to come and worship. Lord, every day with Jesus is sweeter than the day before. And today is better than it's ever been. Lord, I love to see our congregation hugging one another and welcoming guests and just sharing with one another. It was a great time to see us share together in our welcoming time. And Lord, we do want to pray for Ken this morning. We lift him to you. We pray, Father, that you would pass these stones, and Lord, that you would allow him to get on with his ministry. Help us as a church to be generous to him. Lord, we know this didn't catch you by surprise. Shocked me this morning when I found out I was going to have to preach again. Lord, but we're looking forward to what you're going to say, because I had no clue, but I do now. And Lord, I look forward to hearing from you. I also want to pray for Alan, and I want to pray, Lord, that you would be with him. And Lord, as they put in the stent, that things would go well for him. For Lori, we lift her to you. We pray for Zoanne. We lift her to you, Lord. We lift up each one in our church that is suffering, and pray for everyone in the hospital today, Lord. We just lift them to you and pray for the doctors and nurses. Father, again, thank you for allowing us to worship with you today, and ask you to bless our day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We've got a wagon that's going to be coming around, and it's just a reminder, this wagon, all right, bring it on around, is for our Christmas child. Just to remind you that this month we're collecting wash rags and we're collecting soap and no liquid soaps. Make sure they are bar soaps, that kind of thing. But you'll see the wagon starting to get full. It's kind of exciting to see that you're being a part of this. And next month, we'll have another thing. And this young man has agreed to take it through the auditorium. And just to remind you, and y'all give him a hand. Thank you this morning for doing that. Also, quick reminder, we have a deacons meeting at 5 o'clock today. And then tonight we have a short business meeting. And we have time. We're going to, we have about two more of our discs on Dr. Jeremiah. Is this the end? We'll show one. If we don't, we'll show it next week. But anyway, be here for this evening's service. And thank you for joining us today. If you're visiting with us today, we have two ladies here at the front that are going to make their way to the back. And if you would, raise your hand and wave to them. They've got a little gift they want to give you this morning. Sorry, guys. I'm still in shock that I'm preaching today.
Brother Royce, I gave you that sermon text you could use. It said John 11:35, Jesus wept. 2 points and you're done. Jesus, and he cried. See? Easy. Let's worship together again this morning. Would you stand, please, as we sing about our blessed Redeemer who died for us, that we can live through him. Page number 326, if you would, please. Up Calvary's Mountain. Up Calvary's Mountain. and one dreadful morn. Watch Christ my Savior, weary and worn, facing for sinners death on the cross, that he might save them from endless loss. Blessed Redeemer, precious Redeemer, seems now I see him on Calvary's tree, wounded and bleeding, for sinners pleading, blind and unheeding, dying for me. Father, forgive them, thus did he pray.
Eat while his high blood flowed fast away, praying for sinners while in such woe. No one but Jesus ever lost so. Blessed
for us, that we could be cleansed of all of our sin. Page number 333, if you would please. Oh, the blood of Jesus.
Oh,
it soothes my doubts, it calms my fears, and it dries all God that gives me strength from day to day. It will never lose its power. Well, it reaches to the highest mountain, and yes, it flows to the lowest valley. The blood that gives me strength from day to day, it will never lose its power. It will never lose. It will never lose. It will never lose its power. Do you believe that? Thank you so much. You may be seated. This.
Will you bow your heads with me and let us pray? Blessed Heavenly Father, Pastor lifted up many names to us this morning for our prayers. We ask you bless each one, heal each one, be with the doctors and nurses that minister to them. Please, Lord, give them special words of knowledge, special techniques and abilities to heal our brothers and sisters. Father, we ask you be with each one here in our congregation. There are many here that are hurting. We ask for their healing also. Father, please bless our nation. Please keep our president safe. Father, we ask that you be with us in a powerful way and help us to bring revival to our church and let it increase in membership and in the work that it does in the community. We thank you for our pastor and all who labor for you here. We ask you to be with Brother Morton in a special way. He was struck down on his way here to minister to us. Please revive him. Father, we thank you for all the blessings we've received this past week. Lord, we return now our tithes and offerings to you, and it's in Jesus' holy, precious name that we pray. Amen.
We got it. Can you hear me now? Not an advertisement now, folks. You know, the parable of the prodigal son is a beautiful example of the Lord's love, of the Lord's grace, and of the Lord's forgiveness. This song sort of goes along with that. And I found it quite powerful, especially when you're singing it. Anytime, Jeff.
Mm-hmm. Almighty God, the great I am, immovable rock, omnipotent, powerful, awesome Lord, victorious warrior, commanding King of Kings, mighty conqueror, and the only time, the only time I ever saw him run was when he ran to me. He took me in his arms, held my head to his chest, and said, "My son's come home again." Lifted my face, wiped the tears from my eyes, with forgiveness in his voice, he said, "Son, do you know I still love you?" He caught me by surprise when God ran. The day I left home, I knew I'd broken his heart, and I wondered then if things could ever be the same. Then one night, I remembered his love for me, and down that dusty road ahead I could see it was the only time. It was the only time I ever saw him run. And then he ran to me. He took me in his arms, held my head to his chest, and said, "My son's come home again." Lifted my face, wiped the tears from my eyes, with forgiveness in his voice, he said, "Son, do you know I still love you?" He caught me by surprise, and he brought me to my knees when God ran. I was so ashamed, all alone and so far away, but now I know. Said, "My son's come home again." Lifted my face, wiped the tears from my eyes, with forgiveness in his voice, I felt his love for me again. He ran to me, he took me in his arms, held my head to his chest, and said, "My son's come home again." Lifted my face, wiped the tears from my eyes, with forgiveness in his voice, said, "Son," he called me son. He said, "Son, do you know I still love you?" When God ran, when God.
Amen. Wow. Beautiful. I'm glad God ran to me.
Amen.
Whew. He took this fella that had dyslexia that I figured there had no way. When God called, I thought he'd made a mistake. And sometimes I still do. I think about the poor people that have to listen to me. And I was reminded this morning of that as I began praying about this morning's service. When Alton, well, actually, he called. I was in the shower, and he couldn't get up with me. He called Coach, and Coach turned around and called me, and by then I'd got to the bedroom, and he said, "Are you sitting down?" And I said, "Uh-oh, what's up?" He said, "Well, Ken has got kidney stones, and he's having to go to the hospital." I said, "Oh, no." He said, "So you're on." I said, "Thanks, Coach. Good news." So as I got to praying about this and thinking about how inadequate I feel sometimes, I was reminded of a little guy. His name is Gideon. So if you'll turn with me to Judges, the sixth chapter, I want to share with you some thoughts that have come to my mind about this passage of Scripture that I believe God wants for each one of us. You know, Gideon, it says in chapter 6, verse 1, it said the children of Israel had done evil in the sight of the Lord. So he had delivered them into the hands of the Midians for 7 years. For 7 years, they came into the country and they actually took, and every time they planted crops, they would come and reap those crops for themselves. They would steal their livestock. And the people were finding themselves hiding from the Midianites. They were coming into the country like locusts and just ransacking the country and stealing everything they had. So in verse 11, we see Gideon now. And it says in verse 11, it says, "The angel of the Lord came and sat under a terrapin tree, which is in Ophrah, which belongs to Joaz the Abizurite. And while his son Gideon was threshing wheat in the winepress, in order to hide from the Midians, an angel of the Lord appeared to him and said to him, 'The Lord is with you, O mighty man of valor.' And Gideon said to him, 'Oh, my Lord, if the Lord is with us, why then has all this happened to us? And where are all the miracles which our fathers have told us about, saying, did not the Lord bring up us from Israel? But now the Lord has forsaken us and delivered us into the hands of the Midianites.' Then the Lord turned to him and says, 'Go in this might of yours, and you shall save Israel from the hands of the Midians. Have I not sent you?' So he said to them, 'Oh, my Lord, how can I save Israel? Indeed, my clan is the weakest in all of Manasseh, and I am the least in my father's house.' And the Lord said to him, 'Surely I will be with you, and you shall deliver the Midians as one man.'" Now, what is Gideon saying here? He is saying, "I'm inadequate for this job." He said, "Look, I'm the least in my father's house. We're a small clan of people. Who do you think you're calling?" You know, I can remember when God called me, I kind of asked some of the same questions. I said, "Lord, look, I can't even read well." In fact, y'all see that sometimes. Dyslexia is something when both sides of the brain start working at once and all of a sudden things start moving. And sometimes when I'm reading, it hits me and it scares me to death as I'm staring at words trying to get them to stop moving. So I understand being inadequate. But God calls Gideon an inadequate man, and he says, "I'm going to take you on an incredible adventure. And I'm looking at some people that feel just like that." God calls inadequate people and takes them on incredible adventures. You know, I'm looking at some. In fact, if I had a title for this, it would be "The Hero in Your Mirror." When you got up this morning and you looked at that mirror, there was a hero looking back at you. You say, it was me. That's what Gideon said. Wait a minute. Time out. Time out, Lord. I'm inadequate. God likes to call inadequate people. You remember David, little shepherd boy? He chose him. And I mean, David was just a ruddy looking little guy. His brothers couldn't believe it. His father didn't even want to send him to be chosen because he said, "It can't be David. But guess what? He put David right up against Goliath. Why did he do it? Well, he didn't want a Goliath fighting a Goliath. He wanted a little shepherd boy to defeat him, to show that it was in the hands of Almighty God that it took place. God chooses inadequate people, just like you and I, and he wants to take us on incredible adventures. Church, God is looking at our church, and he wants to take us on an incredible adventure. He sees potential in us. He sees potential that we can make a difference in Mountain Home. But not just in Mountain Home, we can make a difference around the world. We can make a difference in Oklahoma and Missouri and Texas. We can, all around us, we can make a difference. But we've got to be willing to be used, just like Gideon. Now this little guy, who was the least in his father's clan, was scared. You say, what? Yeah, let me show you. Look over at verse 25. It says, now it came to pass the same night that the Lord said to him, take your father's youngest bull, the second bull of 7 years old, and tear down the altars of Baal in your father's house, and cut down the wooden images that is beside it, and build an altar to the Lord your God on top of a rock in proper arrangements, and take the second bull and offer a burnt offering with the wood of the image which you shall cut down. So Gideon took 10 men from among his servants and did as the Lord said to him. But because he feared his father's household and the men of the city too much to do it by day, he did it by night. He feared the men of the city. Let me tell you, God calls fearful people on faithful adventures. God calls fearful people, just like you and I, just like Gideon. Some of those that are afraid, can God really use me? I know who I am. Can God really use me? Here's Gideon, and God tells him, I want you to go back to your dad's house, and I want you to take and cut down that Asher pole, which was something like we would say is a totem pole. It's a thing that they would worship. They would fall down and worship before God, their God, that they had made with their hands. And God says, I want you to take and go cut it down. Tear down that altar. I want you to build an altar to me. And I want you to take that second bull of your father, and I want you to kill it and offer it to me. Now, why the second bull? I think it probably is because the first one was already dedicated to Baal. But God, I don't know the reason, but I know this. He was afraid to do it. He was scared to death. His knees were knocking. Have you ever felt like God wanted you to do something and you went at it with fear and trembling? Or maybe I'm looking at some that haven't ever gone after it because fear overcame you. That's a work of Satan. You know, that is one of the areas where he works in your life and mine, is to hit us with fear and say, you can't do it. This morning at 8:30, when that phone call came and the realization came that I'm going to have to speak in front of people and I have not prepared, my heart went in my throat and I said, Lord, I'm really fearful. Satan is working on me right now. But you know what? Sometimes when we're afraid, God is at his best. He steps up when we step out in faith to say, okay, God, I'm going to do it, but I don't know what I'm going to say. I'm going to step up in front of them people and I'm going to try to share a message. But you know that me and you have not had that much time together on this message. God calls fearful people. Now, I want to tell you, I'm looking at some people that fall into that category. If that mirror was standing here right now and you were to look at it and you see that person that's afraid, just like Gideon, he feared his father's household. He feared him so much he wouldn't do it by day. He did it by night. But at least he did it. For some of us, we haven't done anything yet. We're kind of sitting back waiting. Saying maybe when we get a pastor, we'll do something. Folks, that ain't the way God works. God wants us doing it now. He wants each one of us stepping out by faith and getting involved. God doesn't want us to sit on the sidelines. He wants each one of us in the game. He was afraid. But I like what happened. Look over at verse 29. It says, so they said one to another, now this is the men of the city, who has done these things? And when they had inquired and asked, they said, Gideon, the son of Joash, has done these things. Then the men of the city said to Joash, bring out your son that he may die, because he has turned, tore down the altar of Baal, and because he has cut down the wooden image that was beside it. So Joash said to all those who stood against him, who would plead for Baal? Would you save him? Let the one who would plead for him be put to death by morning. If he is a god, let him plead for himself, because the altar has been torn down. In other words, his dad steps up and he says, if Baal is really the god, then let Baal fight the fight. You don't have to fight the fight. I mean, his dad stood up, but I guarantee you, God put that in his dad's mind to say to those men, if you're going to kill my son, you need to be killed if Baal doesn't kill him, because Baal is your god. Let him fight his fight. I like that. You know, but what was happening is God's fighting the fight right now. He's showing them that that wooden image that you created with your own hands is not really God. I remember one time in India, I was standing and I had a young lady and we were sharing the gospel with some guys that were making cows that were one of their gods. By the way, when you go to India, you have to dodge cows in the road. They just walk free. They worship these cows. But they were taking cow dung and making idols out of it. We couldn't hardly breathe as we were standing there, as these men are molding these things, letting them dry, and then they paint them, and then people bow down and worship. And as I stood there and started talking to them, I told them, I want to tell you about the God who created heaven and earth. I said, see these mountains behind you? He made them. You see, he made the stars in the sky. He made the fish in the river. He made the birds that fly. And they're sitting there and their eyes are getting big, and I'm sharing the gospel, and I talk to them about Adam and Eve, and I go all the way through the gospel to where God sends his only son. And I'm looking at those guys and I said, now what you have to decide is, if you want eternal life, you have to be willing to give your life to Jesus and ask him to forgive you of your sins and come into your life. And one looks at the other one and he says, we won't be able to make our cows anymore. And the other one says, no, we couldn't do that. And then one turns and he says, let's get rid of him. Run him off. Run him off. And my translator said, uncle, we need to leave. And we walked away. And my heart broke as I thought about those men that just heard the gospel and refused to quit making cows out of cow dung. So, because it was their job. They were more concerned about making a little money than they were a relationship with the living God that created heaven and earth and all that is within. They were afraid. God can overcome fear. He showed Gideon, I'm taking care of you. When his dad stood up to those men, you would think at that point that Gideon would say, wow, man, what a God I serve. This is phenomenal. But it didn't happen. I want you to look on down with me in verse 36. It says, so Gideon said to God, if you will save Israel by your hands, as you have said, look, I shall put a fleece of wool on a threshing floor. If there is dew on the fleece only, and it is dry on all the ground, then I shall know that you will save Israel by your hand, as you have said. And it was, when he rose early the next morning, he squeezed out the fleece together, and he wrung the dew out of the fleece, a bowl full of water. And Gideon said to God, don't be angry with me, but let me speak just once more. Let me test, I pray, just one more time with the fleece. Let it now be dry on the fleece, but let there, but on the ground let it be dew. And the Lord did so that night, and it was dry on the fleece only, but there was dew on all the ground. God calls doubting people to daring adventures. He tells Gideon, you know, Gideon says to God, and he's already seen God work, but he still has doubts. I'm looking at some doubting people right now. But God calls doubting people to daring adventures. He loves it sometimes when we doubt, because he shows up. Now I can see Gideon. He said, now I'm going to put this fleece out here, and I want it to be wet, but I want the ground dry, so I'll know it's you. The next morning he goes out and he picks that thing up and he wrings out that bowl full, and he's standing there. And then he gets to thinking, you know, this could have been Hezekiah's sheepdog that came by. And he thinks, did I do this right? I might need to redo this thing. He said, God, don't get mad with me, but I think I want to do it again. But this time I want that fleece dry and the ground wet. So the next morning he comes walking out there, walking through that wet dew, and he picks up that powdered dry piece of wool, throws it up, and it floats down into his hand, and he knows that God has answered his prayer. God calls doubting people to daring adventures. He's looking at some doubters right now. Some of you are saying, will our church ever be anything? It will if we'll let God. If we'll do what God asked us to do, it can happen, and it can happen fast. God calls doubting people to daring adventures. He called this doubter. Today, Ken was supposed to be with us, and I remember working with Wycliffe Bible Translator, and his name was Jim Winters. We were in the bush in Senegal, West Africa. We're working with the Basari. First time I met Jim, we were doing an AIDS conference, and I had one of our guys over there that was speaking, Carl Garvin. Y'all met him and his wife, Kay, one time. They spoke to us. Well, Carl was speaking on AIDS. He was a medic in Vietnam, and I gave him that assignment. And I was sitting there in the crowd, and all I could see was white eyes everywhere and white teeth. It was dark. And I looked over, and here come a white guy walking in the midst, and he had on these African pants. And I looked over and I thought, where in the world's that guy from? So finally I got up and I walked back to him and I stood over beside him and I said, I don't believe I've seen you before. He said, no. He said, I'm living here with the Basari. I'm trying to learn their language. And I said, really? He said, yeah. I said, where are you from? And he said, North Carolina. I said, well, I'm from North Carolina. That's pretty cool. I said, what are you doing here? And he said, I'm a Wycliffe Bible translator. He said, the Basari does not have a written language. In fact, they can't read, they can't write. And he said, my goal is to learn their language and to put a Bible into their language. I remember sometimes later, I took another team back to that same area, and we got there, and we were supposed to stay in a new tribe's place, and we got there and found out that they didn't have a place for us to stay, that some other group had come in that worked with them, and they couldn't let us stay. So here I am with 23 people in the bush in Africa, nowhere to stay. And I said, Lord, and you know me, I'm always sending up flare prayers. Help me, Lord. Help me. And about that time, here comes Jim Winters driving up. And I said, Jim, I need help. I said, what? I said, we don't have a place to stay, man. I've got 23 people with me. We've got this bus. We've got some that are supposed to be going out in the bush. He said, I know they're working with the Basari. They're working with me. And I said, and some of us are staying here, and we're going to do basketball camps and speak in schools and do some evangelism, pass out Bibles in this area. He said, well, some of you can stay at my house, and let's me and you go. And we went to another place, and there was a hunting village where they had little huts. And he talked with them, and they let us put each one up in these huts. So the team that was staying in town, we put into this little hut village, and the other ones we sent out to the bush. Our bus took them out there, dropped them off, came back, and they told me, they said, we're not going back to get them. We blowed out two tires. It's too dangerous to take a bus there. Now I've got a group of 14 people in the bush, and I've got to figure out a way to get them back. I looked at Jim, and I said, Jim, I'm sorry to have to lean on you, brother, but I need help again. I told him what it was. He ran around. He ended up finding a couple of people with Land Rovers, and they went out to that bush, and he went with them, and they came back. They were a week later, their faces all covered in red clay. They were so happy. They had no idea what we had been through during that period of time. But I so appreciated Jim. But you know, half the time I was doubting what I was going to do. I didn't know what to do, but God knew what to do. And I have learned that God calls doubting people on some of the most daring adventures of their life. And I'm looking at some people that need to remember that. First of all, God calls inadequate people on incredible adventures. Gideon said, I'm inadequate, Lord. And some of you say the same thing. Some of you say, well, I'm afraid. I'm scared. I can't work with children. I can't drive a van, or I can't do this, or I can't do that. I'm afraid. God calls fearful people to faithful adventures. And then lastly, God calls doubting people on daring adventures. I'm going to end with one other story that I want to share with you. Is in Louisville, Kentucky, several years ago, Bailey Smith did a crusade. And in that crusade, he presented the gospel. And he talked about how Jesus, whenever he came to the end of his life, and after he had been risen from the dead on the Mount of Olives, ascended back into heaven. But before he went, he said, each and every one of you who have received the gospel of Jesus Christ, each one of you are to go into all the world and preach the gospel. That's what Jesus said. He said, when you receive the Holy Spirit, when I come to live within you, you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, to the ends of the earth. He said, that means you start right where you're at, and you go out from there. He said, that's what you're to do. And I'm commissioning each one of you to do your part. Over about the third row up, on the right side, sat a little mentally retarded young man. That young man was sitting there with tears in his eyes. And he came forward and he committed his life to go and tell people about Jesus. The next day, downtown Louisville, Kentucky, a young man drags a beam of wood right out into the middle of an intersection and lays it down. He goes back to the other side and he gets another piece of beam of wood and he drags it out and he lays it across to form a cross on that thing and he drops it. Now he's got two beams of wood laying there. And he's looking and traffic stopping in every direction. And he's standing there and he said, and he started pointing to the people and pointing to the cross. The police came. Some of the policemen were Christians. People out of the car said, what is he doing? What is that boy doing? What's wrong with him? And they said, he's trying to tell you about Jesus. What are you talking about? And they stood there for that young man and shared Jesus with that crowd. People at that intersection got saved that day because of one mentally retarded boy who came to an altar at a Bailey Smith crusade and prayed and committed himself to sharing the gospel. And the next day went out and did his best to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. If that young man can share the gospel, can't we? Can't we do what God asked us to do? God calls inadequate people. That young man was probably as inadequate as anybody was. But God used him powerfully. You tell me he wasn't afraid to pull that log right out in traffic and stop traffic. And to pull that other one out knowing that what was God going to do with this young man? What was going to happen? His confidence was in God. And I'm sure he was afraid. And I'm sure he had his own doubts in his mind. But my doubts are not that God will not show up. I know if I'm doing it for Jesus, God's going to show up. Church, it's time that we do what God asked us to do. And it's time that we realize that God calls inadequate people like you and I. And I'm sure if Ken was here today and not fighting kidney stones, he'd tell you the same thing. I didn't know God could ever use me. But he chose me to go to those people that don't have a language and share the gospel. Today, I make a plea with each one of you that you would pray about what God would have you to do for a man that came all the way from North Carolina this way to share this morning and is not able to do it. So I'm trying to stand in his stead and tell you that God wants to use you too. And he wants to use Ken. And he wants to use each and every one of us because there's a lost and dying world outside these doors that need Jesus. And it's not about us. It's about him. It's not about what we do. It's about what he has already done. And our job is to go into all the world and preach the gospel. Will we do it? Will we be willing to do what Jesus asked us to do? As he called on a young man and he called him a mighty man of valor. And he said, wait a minute. I'm the least most unlikely person that could ever be a mighty man of valor. God says, I've chosen you. Church, he's chosen you. He's put this church in one of the most strategic places in Mountain Home, right here on the bypass. There's no reason we can't have the greatest church in all of Mountain Home. But it won't happen till God's people step up and say, I'm willing. I'm willing to do what God wants us to do, and I'm willing to go. And the question is this morning, are we willing? Will we be that hero in the mirror? When we get up in the morning or you go home this afternoon, you look in that mirror. I want you to remember you're looking at a hero. But you can make you a zero if you do nothing. I don't want to be a zero. I want to be a hero. Don't you? Don't you want God to use you? This morning we're going to have a time of invitation. And that invitation just very simply. If God's spoken to your heart this morning, respond. This is a time when we respond to what God has said to us. You know, God called me and it was hard for me to move because I knew my disabilities. I knew what I couldn't do. I could not hardly read. I just barely squeaked out of school. We had 897 in my graduating class and I was 896. I was that close to not getting out. And the guy in front of me had tried five times to get out. I mean, he'd been in 12th grade over and over and over again. But let me tell you, God don't make mistakes. He uses people like Gideon, like myself. And he's looking for people just like you. And God wants to use you. But the question this morning, are you willing to let him use you? If you're here this morning and you don't have a relationship with Jesus Christ, just like those men that were making that cow out of cow dung, you've heard it this morning. Jesus loves you. He gave his life for you. You were sick and he came to earth and made a house call. You needed a doctor. He came with a blood transfusion. He gave his blood for your sins so your sins could be removed. But the question is, what will you do with it? Will you accept that free gift of eternal life that he offers? Or will you sit right there and do nothing? It's up to you. If I could walk the aisle for you, I would. But if you're here this morning and you want Jesus as your Lord and Savior, if you'll come down, I'll be glad to share with you. If you'd like to join this church, this is the time. You just come and let us know and we'll have somebody talk with you and get your information. We'd love to have you be a part of it. Our goal is to reach the world with the gospel. Then after we get through this morning, we're going to have our deacons at the back door. And I'm going to ask you to give a special offering to Ken, who couldn't be here today to preach a message. And he probably could have done a heck of a lot better job than I did. But I'm going to tell you, God chose me today to speak. And I've tried to give you the best message I could. And now I'm going to ask you, what will you do with what Jesus has said today, what God said to you? Father, I thank you for each one that's here today. I thank you for this message about Gideon and how you do call inadequate people and take them on incredible adventures. And you call fearful people and take them on faithful adventures. And then you call us doubters and you take us on that daring adventure. Lord, some of us doubt that we could ever be used of you, but Lord, today would you use us? Father, today I commit myself again, afresh and anew to you, and I ask you, Lord, to do something mighty in this church and mighty in me, because I love you and I thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.